Thank you. Coming forward for the sacrament of our Lord's body and blood at that time. There's a little description of how we do that in the Episcopal Church in the Holy Communion section of your bulletin, so give that a look if you're unfamiliar. Several announcements to call your attention to. March 20th at 3:30 in Lewis Hall, we'll be having a gathering. The principal event of that will be Mr. Lynn Dobson, principal of Dobson Pipe Organ Builders, telling us about the work that's happening related to our instrument. And then that evening, we'll at 5:30, we will have the Sabbath Mater Palm Sunday Choral Evensong. So this is what I envision. I'm communicating my expectations to you clearly, that I might hold you accountable. You see, you have to be clear if you're going to hold people accountable. So what I envision happening is all of us gathering in the parish house to hear Mr. Lynn Dobson, to have a reception, and then we will make our way down here for choral evensong on Palm Sunday. Everybody got that? All right, straightforward, clear? I like it. All right, let's see, what else? Newcomers welcome reception this Thursday, March 10th, 5:30 to 7 in the parish house. And then we have a new ministry developing, a floral guild workshop to do flowers in the church. All the information is there. And the deadline for Easter lilies is Friday, March 18th. Again, welcome one another.
Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
We say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We do not love you with our whole hearts. We do not love our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Day after the Passover, on that very day,
Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of property that will belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country. He began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have enough bread to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has got him back, safe and sound.' And he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. When this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
midst of one of my favorite seasons of the year. That primary election cycle. I take it you all are aware that this is happening in our lives. I really do enjoy this time in our national life. I love watching the debates, witnessing the candidates posture and plant their flags in the ground, wearing their American flag lapel pins, trying to show who's the most patriotic, who has a handle on all the things that are important, the economy, jobs, the military, all of those things that do matter in our national life. These are all marks of the season in which we're in. And at some point, the candidates will make that turn from speaking to the base to solidify the foundation of their candidacy, to addressing the specifics and their specific approaches to governance. We are clearly not quite there yet. But again, it's still early in the season. We're also in the midst of another one of my favorite seasons, the season of Lent. And there are certain expectations embedded within us that relate to this time as well. We know that we're looking out there toward Easter. And here on this fourth Sunday of Lent, it's not quite so far away any longer. We know that we're preparing the way of the Lord to come once again into our lives with that promise of new life and a new way of being in the world. This season is about sacrifice and making room in our normally unfocused, harried, and hectic lives for God to come and reign. Now, there's long been a tension about the purpose of this season. There's been a long-standing emphasis on penitence, on sacrifice and discipline, and all those features of this season are very important. But sometimes we have this tendency to think that the essence of this season is about self-punishment for self-punishment's sake. And we allow that to cloud the emphasis of preparation as the purpose. As a child, I really took this to heart and found myself really caught up in that negative side of penitence. Growing up in the Episcopal Church, we had a rector in the church where I grew up, God rest his soul, that had a flair for the dramatic, shall we say. And I remember him delivering the words on Ash Wednesday for the imposition of ashes. He did sort of a hybrid of the 1928 prayer book and a scriptural line. There, kneeling at the altar, he would approach us with that black, ash-laden thumb, preparing to make the sign of the cross, and he would say, "Remember, man, that thou art but dust." and unto dust shalt thou return. Remember, man, that thou art but dust. Now, at that point, I was about the age of some of these guys up here. And I would look around to my peers in the pews, and we would look at each other, pointing at the altar and pointing to one another, saying to ourselves, "Oh no, it's that time again. Father has brought out the butt dust." Where does he get this stuff? And what have I done that's so bad that I must be smeared with butt dust? I knew from that time forward that Lynch was a serious and bad, bad time. Yet here we are, in the midst of this season. And one of the hallmarks of this season is we hear the parable that we just heard from Luke's gospel. It's the only time we hear this parable in the lectionary in the course of the church year. We engage this thing in several different ways from several different vantage points. And perhaps we all feel a slightly different kind of emphasis and identify with the different characters at work in the drama. Many identify with the older son, who has been steady as she goes and right as rain. Dependable, accountable, steadfast. He ought to be mad, we think. He deserves his place. He deserves primacy in relationship in this family. It's not fair, we think, as the story unfolds. Many of us perhaps look at the younger son, who's made quite a mess of it all. If you've ever made a mess of anything, it's nice to know that a pleasant return is possible. Forgiveness is in short supply in the world in which we live, and it often seems too much to hope for. But I think in this season of Lent, the reason we come to terms with this parable every season of Lent is that we're to focus beyond the two sons and we're to look to that magnificent Father. Remember all the details of the parable. The young son goes to his father and he says, "Dad, I want what's going to be mine when you depart this life." The father, rather than putting up any argument, gives his son a pocket full of cash, and the younger son blows right out of town with it. And when he gets out of town, he blows through the resources that fill his pockets. And it gets bad. It gets very bad. He's hungry. He's lonely. He's despondent. He needs help, and he doesn't know where to turn. Yet, in the midst of it all, in an important moment, he remembers the kind of man that his father is. And it gives him hope. So he develops his approach along the way. He'll go home. He'll throw himself on his father's mercy and let the chips fall where they may. Turns out, the younger son is right about the kind of man that his father is. His father sees him at a distance, doesn't know the story, doesn't know anything about what's transpired in this distant country. The father doesn't ask for a report, just goes to the son to welcome him home. The younger son's got the story that he wants to tell, but the father won't even listen to it. Sends the servant for clothes, for food, for the sign of family. The father barely hears the apology that the younger son offers. The father delivers no ultimatum, articulates no new terms. He just welcomes the son home. See, we tell this story in this season to remember what it's all about. We're not disciplining ourselves to become worthy somehow. We're not hoping to earn God's love or favor in this season of special devotion. We're saying our prayers, engaging in devotion, and making room in our lives for one purpose. One single, simple purpose. To remember who God is. What kind of God we know God to be. Friends, the good news is crystal clear. As Paul said, God doesn't see the world or us from a human vantage point. God sees us the way God will, with mercy and compassion and a simple desire for one thing. Have us home, to have us close, to love us, and bind us together as one. In God, we find hope. We might make a mess of it. We can't earn it. We certainly don't deserve it. I think today I will get up and go to my father. Today, I will get up and go to my father.
book of common prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and revel your glory, reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the College of William and Mary. We pray for peace in the Middle East. We pray for the millions of refugees displaced by the Syrian civil war. We pray for your wisdom that we may be a unified people, at peace among ourselves, and a blessing to other nations. And we pray for those listed in the bulletin for whom our prayers have been asked. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them a courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, especially Carol B. Tenbrook and Robert Fairley Tully, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that you may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil and live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of them, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses.
gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith.